Hi everyone, this is Annie Dance. I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lure, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Today, Wednesday, October 9th, 2024, the North Carolina General Assembly will consider measures to fund Hurricane Helene relief. So, this is a special edition of Today at the NCGA. Please subscribe if you haven't already and support my independent journalism. First up is a press conference by House Speaker Tim Moore. Let's see what he has to say with a special edition of Today at the NCGA.
Session. Staff, as I think everybody in this room and everybody across North Carolina knows, has been extremely trying. It's been an emotional experience that is ongoing for our state. We've lost dozens of North Carolinians to the storm. Many more are still missing and unaccounted for. Lives have been forever altered as a result of this. Areas of many towns are unrecognizable, some even washed away completely. Roads have been obliterated. Power is needed still in many places. Recovering from Hurricane Helene will be no small task, but I believe we, the state of North Carolina, the people of North Carolina, are up to that task. Today, we're convening for the first Hurricane Helene disaster recovery package. This is just a first step for us to take as legislators. With that, I'll let Speaker Moore talk a little bit more about the provisions of the bill.
Thank you, Phil. Good morning. You always wonder the kinds of things that you'll see and that our communities will go through, and I don't think anybody could foresee what's happened to Western North Carolina. I've visited every single affected county except for one that I'll get to this weekend, met with our members, and some of these folks right here standing behind me today even lost everything they had, lost homes, you name it. And I saw these men and these women, not just these, but folks throughout Western North Carolina who had lost them, who had so much lost themselves, stepping up and helping their neighbors at the emergency operations centers, out coordinating relief, making sure to communicate what is needed, what resources need to be brought in there, making sure that first responders had what they needed to keep doing the heroic job that they did. And it's with all of the tragedy that we've seen in Western North Carolina, we've also seen an incredible amount of humanity that is just it just blew my mind seeing how for example, Jennifer Balkin was up here, helped coordinate with her county to set up a distribution center off of I-26, off of an empty shell building that now looks like a Costco on steroids, with donations coming in, people picking it up, a centralized collection. That's just one example, because all of these folks up here today have contributed in significant ways to trying to take care of the lives in Western North Carolina. As Senator Berger mentioned, we know many have lost their lives. We know that their numbers unaccounted for. Well, we don't know those numbers yet. But we know that every day efforts are being made to get there. The recovery that is going to have to be done is going to be something that is a Herculean task, but it is something that we will get done. The bill that we will be passing today is the first step. It is the first step of others. You will see the adjournment resolution will be modified so that we will be back on October the 24th for session as well, and then that we will also be back in November to deal with other matters. So the particular bill that we are taking up today does an initial appropriation of $273 million. $250 million of that goes to state agencies and local government for federal disaster. Again, we have the federal match that would be applied to $16 million for lost compensation for school nutrition programs, $50 million from existing water sewer reserves, $2 million to provide technical assistance to FEMA for FEMA grants for affected counties. Some may get into more detail, but the amount of paperwork and documentation that has to be done for counties and municipalities to be reimbursed is something that is very complicated. And so we've been working with a number of the associations to help with that. So that's going to help those, particularly those small towns that really need it. $5 million to State Board of Elections for voter outreach and communication in the affected areas. Small business loans through Golden Leaf, reimbursed via FEMA. Absentee ballots returned to any county in the state. And Senator Berger will talk in more detail about the elections piece, but hotline for displaced voters, things like waiving DMV fees and like when someone's license is supposed to expire, they don't have time to mess with that right now. Granting extensions of those, school calendar flexibility, funds flexibility for various agencies. And then we've also waived some certain environmental requirements that we need to get waived, like burning restrictions, wastewater treatment restrictions, and road construction to get this process moving. We don't need the rebuilding. We don't need these efforts tied up in bureaucracy and delay. So trying to do that to streamline it, but there's a lot to it. And so with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Senator Berger, who will talk about the elections pieces.
And as far as the elections part is concerned, the state board adopted a resolution earlier, and that resolution was adopted by unanimous vote of the state board. Much of what we're doing with the legislation today will be a codification of what the state board did. There are some additions. This has been put together in consultation with the state board staff. My staff, speaker staff, has met with staff of the state board in working through a number of these things. So the hurricane has dealt a serious blow to what may very well be the ability to conduct elections in the disaster-related counties. And so the State Board of Elections made a good effort at helping address those problems. We want to extend it to additional counties that were impacted by Hurricane Helene. Right now, the State Board resolution only applies to 13 counties. There are actually 25 counties that are in the federally declared disaster area. So we're extending the State Board action to all 25 of those counties. Essentially, the bill codifies the emergency rules approved by the state board, expands them to 12 more counties that were impacted by the storm. We allow for additional flexibility for appointing election judges and poll workers, including from outside a particular county. And again, this all applies just to those 25 counties, not to the state as a whole. State employees would be eligible to serve as election judges and poll workers without taking leave from their jobs. This also allows the training programs for election officials to be modified to account for the need to bring in new recruits in the affected counties. County boards of election, by bipartisan majority vote, will be able to modify early voting plans that have previously been adopted, including changing sites as well as days and hours of operation. Boards would also be able to make changes to election day polling places, including transferring precincts, combining precincts, or relocation of polling locations. This extends the absentee ballot return options, allowing voters registered in the affected counties to return ballots to any county board of elections, early voting site, or voting place in the state up until 7:30 p.m. on election day. It also allows for in-person absentee ballot requests until 5 p.m. on November the 4th, the day before the election. This establishes procedures for spoiling and reissuing absentee ballots and for curing deficiencies to accommodate voters who have been displaced by the hurricane in the affected counties. Poll observers from outside of a county would be able to serve in the affected counties. The State Board of Elections will be required to establish processes for transmitting out-of-county absentee ballots to the appropriate county, including documentation of the chain of custody of absentee ballots that are transferred from one county to another. Also mandates education efforts, including establishing a hotline for voters impacted by the disaster. These are all common sense steps we can take to ensure that Western North Carolinians in the affected counties can vote no matter where they are in the state of North Carolina. These are things that we discussed with the Board of Elections, and they were providing feedback to us up to and including last night on changes that they suggested that we make. The bill that we will vote on at noon includes those changes recommended by the State Board staff. Now, I want to let members of the Western North Carolina delegation who are with us to talk about what they have been experiencing over the past week and a half. And I don't have any particular order, but Senator Heiss, did you want to speak?
This is by far the most devastating thing I've ever experienced as a community. Many of the areas I represent, all the counties that I represent, have been devastated in this storm. It started Wednesday night. We had a major flooding storm come in before the hurricane, and we're already at flood stages before the hurricane came through. I had entire counties without water, power, sewer, cell service. We've been trying to rescue areas. There's still areas you can't access unless you're on a motorcycle, unless you're on side-by-sides, communities that are tied off. We've had an incredible outpouring from so many communities across the state and others, but we're in a long-term recovery. Today, we've got a lot of things packed up in old school buildings and others, but we'll be distributing for months to get out. Mitchell County, the water treatment system for the entire county, both towns, is gone. It does not exist, and it's unsalvageable. That's a four-year process to put a water treatment plant back in. We don't have a temporary solution for these things right now. Still, people at the fire departments every day who are having the first hot meal they've had in more than 2 weeks. We have a lot of things to ask for. I'm excited to be here today to see that we're asking as a community for the support of the state, and that the state of North Carolina is stepping up to do that initially. And so there's a lot of distrust in the areas I have, but I hope we can begin to show that North Carolina is stepping up to its responsibilities, and we are here for the people of the West. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President, Mr. Speaker, for this first of many efforts that we'll undertake here at the General Assembly. 2 weeks ago today, the rains from the first storm were just working their way through our area, and life was normal. We were checking our emails. Within my firm, we have fantasy football teams that we compete against one another, and we were actually trading players before the weekend. 48 hours later, the mountains will never be the same. We've often complained here in Raleigh as the mountain delegation that the mountains are often forgotten about, that we're often overlooked, and that the rest of the state tends to be the beneficiary of a lot of the efforts that, again, here in Raleigh. We're different. We're mountain folks. We're tough. We're resilient. And we're uncomfortable in the spotlight, but it is needed. When you wake up and there's a total collapse of telecommunications, your power, your water, your sewer, your roads, and your bridges, it is a very isolating event. This is something that is beyond description. And for those of you that have made the pilgrimage to see firsthand with boots on the ground what we're going through, I thank you. I thank Mr. Speaker for actually arranging for a flight for me to travel with him. It's helpful when he's part of your local delegation, so it's beneficial. Mr. President, thank you for convening the Senate for us to take this. But this is the first action, the first chapter of a very long book to rebuilding the mountains and bringing Western North Carolina back to some semblance of where we were 2 weeks ago. So thank you for this press conference. Thank you for this bill that we're voting on today. Again, as Senator Heiss said, we have a long road ahead of us. We still don't know what we don't know. Up in the hills and the hollers, we're still working with folks that are very tough, that still do not want to leave their homes. And it has yet to set in on them that they are cut off from a civilized world, and we're doing our best to get to them. So this is a good effort. This is a great start. I look forward to participating in this effort for many years to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. When the National Weather Service came out with initial reports of this
weather system. I'm not sure that any of us expected the devastation that we've gotten. I represent the farthest eight counties in Western North Carolina. Four of my counties are okay, and four of my counties have received moderate to severe damage. And as been said by my colleagues Heis and Moffitt, this is not a short-term fix. For those that may think that aid can come in 2 weeks, everybody's going to be back to normal. It's just not going to happen. It's going to take weeks and years in some cases. I know my brother and a group from my church today are going back in some areas that do not have access, that can't get out except for on foot or maybe an ATV. The roads are closed, power lines down. The hardest thing all of us dealt with was for a number of days. We had all the folks you see behind me and all the folks that they represent had no power, no internet, and no cell phone service. And some areas are still in that situation. And it's been said there are folks who have not been located yet, have not been found yet. And it's hard to understand unless you live where we live. Some of these areas are extremely remote, extremely hard to get to. And folks are working very hard. I would like to say thank you to the state of North Carolina. DOT, Mr. President, has done an outstanding job, I can say, in my district in helping get roads cleared. Senator McGinnis is our transportation chair. I think I wore his phone out for several days once we got cell phone service trying to get in. Had one community that had 100 homes that one bridge, one road in, one road out. And those 100 people were trapped. They could not get out. Older people need medicine, need food. And so we called, Senator McGinnis called DOT. They got there, put a culvert in, put some gravel down, temporary bridge, and we got people out. One example of the hundreds of things we've had to deal with. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, for this. Thank you for the initial response. Just so you know, we will all be going back to our districts, talking to our counties, our school people, finding out what those capital needs are, what the damages were. We'll kind of figure out what FEMA's paying for, what they're not. And as was alluded to by the speaker, we'll be coming back October 24th, hopefully to take up round two of this recovery. So thank you for being here, and please continue to pray for our constituents in Western North Carolina.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Mr. Speaker, for doing this. I know back home, people are trying to start their lives over again. And like Senator Moffitt said, the lives in the mountains are different. We're strong. We're resilient. We will rebuild. Absolutely. And a lot of times we hate asking for help. I know that myself. And I promised I wasn't going to cry, but people are still needing help, even though they don't ask for it. And this is just a start. This is a start to help give people what they need. Our community has come together, and it's been such a blessing to see the strength that is out in Western North Carolina. They are out. They are people who have lost their homes are volunteering and coming together. And you see it in my warehouse. It is huge. Our county hit the road by Friday. When this started happening, we were already on the phone Thursday calling for shelters. I was working with the commissioner of agriculture to get the ag center up and running for Buncombe County and Henderson. I was already calling. We were already doing what we needed to do to do that. Senator Moffitt has been so helpful. The communication, I think people don't realize how hard it is to communicate when you don't have a cell phone or any way of getting out. And I finally got a text from him, and I thought, oh my gosh, you're alive. Thank God you're okay. Because we did not know. We couldn't get a hold of anyone. And I thank everyone who has sent so much stuff to the West. Thank you. It is being used. It is being needed. Like Senator Moffitt and Senator Heis have said as well, this is a long road, but we are up to the challenge. We will do it, and we have begun to do it. So I want to thank everyone for supporting Western North Carolina that's here today and those around. Thank you. Thank you for everything you're doing for us. And again, I'll echo what they've said. This is a start, and we're beginning to see that. And I hope everyone in Western North Carolina knows that we love them and care about them here. And we're going to start helping you get back together. Thank you.
Good morning.
Thank you for being here. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Mr. President. I am Mike Clampett, representing Swain, Jackson, and Transylvania counties in the 119th House District. I'm very appreciative of the cooperation of my Western colleagues and all the state's employees and assistants from all departments of state government. Communication, because we did not have cell service or internet service, that was the Achilles heel that we suffered in the mountains. I'm here to bring a different perspective with that communication. The local radio station, WRGC in Silva, Jackson County, and sister station, WBHN in Bryson City, Swain County, along with Roy Burnett and Andy Rogers, were beneficial in assisting myself in getting information to the area. That was the only communication we had was AM and FM radio. The hurricane had all communication completely stymied, and with many technical difficulties, some power interruptions, signal rerouting, both stations remained on the air for the entire time. They took my calls live to be able to relay important information. It's important to note here, they did this remotely outside North Carolina. They had moved a portable remote to Nashville to cover an event there. And because of that, I was able to call from a location, a satellite fire station in Swain County, and I was able to give real-time information to the public, which is very critical at a time like this. People want to know what we're doing or what's happening. Their ability to have served in the area is to be commended and to be recognized. I am very grateful for that and appreciative. Thank all y'all for being here today. Thank you for the opportunity to do this. And it sort of reemphasizes sometimes it's the simple things that work the best. AM and FM radio, that's how we communicate in the mountains. Thank you.
Thank you all. My name is Dudley Green. I'm the representative in the House for District 85, which is Avery, Mitchell, Yancey, and McDowell counties. And I won't spend a lot of time reiterating what some of my colleagues have said, but there was not a corner of my district that wasn't impacted, if not decimated, by this storm. I just wanted to relay my appreciation for my colleagues. Number of them have reached out, and Mr. Speaker, particularly, trying to address what needs we can, find out what our needs are. I appreciate leadership in both chambers bringing this bill today. The injury has occurred. Hopefully, we're starting to get the bleeding stopped up that way, and this will be the first step towards healing to begin. I also want to reiterate our thanks and communicate to our friends downstate and south from everywhere where relief has come in. My hometown doesn't even have a grocery store open yet, and it's going to be weeks, even though things are getting back at a snail's pace. It's going to be weeks before we even have a grocery store open. So if someone could get out, there's nothing to be had there. So I just want to reiterate, this is going to be a long process. We're going to continue to need those things. I think there was some confusion early on. This is not, we have supplies up there to last probably a 2 or 3 weeks, but this is going to be 8, 9, 10 weeks, who knows? And we have been fortunate so far in that it's been temperate weather for us to get out there and work in to try to recover. But we're starting to look now. This morning, the lows were in the 40s. Next week, they're going to be in the 30s. We still have people in shelters. So we're starting to look towards what's a housing solution for folks up there? What's a heating solution for folks up there? So as people are asking you what's needed up there, things like kerosene heaters, blankets, warm coats, things of that nature, please keep that in mind. We appreciate the response from all the local emergency agencies, first responders, and so forth. our line workers, the power people trying to get power, communication workers trying to get communications back out there. Slowly but surely, we hope that we can get the healing started. But I thank you.
I'm Representative Mark Pless, House District 118. I represent Haywood and Madison County. And I can't say enough thanks to the folks of North Carolina for what you've done, but specifically the folks that are in the mountains right now. There were some challenges initially that could not be met for reasons that we will determine, but the folks stepped up and it was people going to grocery stores and buying water and getting it to people that they could distribute until the state of North Carolina kicked in. And now we have truckloads of things that are coming in. And we certainly do appreciate that. We're going to find the people as best we can, and we're going to help the folks that need help. There have been losses. And I met with DHHS this morning to discuss some of the mental health concerns that are going to come out of this. And we're gonna work on some folks, and we're gonna help them get back where they need to be, because this is things that no one should ever see. This is things no one should ever experience, but we have to get back into perspective of folks being able to deal with that and go on with their lives, because life doesn't stop here. It really doesn't. But I wanna speak to some of the concerns that I have as a co-chair of the Emergency Management Oversight and Disaster Committees in the House. I'm concerned, just like everyone else, that we didn't do everything correct. I'm not going to dismiss everything I've heard as being misinformation, but I am going to say there's a time and there is a place for us to figure out what went wrong. I've sat in on hearings for Matthew Florence and Tropical Storm Fred. There's no one in this room that's perfect, and there's no agency in this state that's perfect, but we need to figure out what didn't work. We need to figure out what didn't happen. And we need to put North Carolina on a path to where, as these storms come, and there will be more, we don't repeat the same mistakes. So I want to speak to the folks in the mountains specifically that have been saying a lot of things about the frustrations. We hear you. We really do hear you. And we are going to find out, trust us, but you're going to have to give us some time, because getting people in safe locations and taking care of folks that are hurt is going to be the priority for several months. Please be patient with us. And if you need anything, reach out to any of your representatives. That's what we're here for, is to represent you and to fight for you. And I can assure you that we will do that. But let's kind of set back for right now and help our communities and get them where they need to be, and just trust us to find out what we need to do differently. The only reason that other areas of this state have not experienced this is because the storm hasn't hit you yet. But there will be other storms and there will be other events that we need to be prepared for, just like with what Florida is going through today. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Representative Blair Edens, and I'm also a full-time employee of Samaritan's Purse. Let me be clear, I'm not a spokesperson for Samaritan's Purse, but I know who was first on the ground, and it was us, and we got there, and we're going to be there till this storm's over. There's a significant loss of life in the western part of our state, and I just I want to say thank you to all the volunteers from all over the country that are showing up. We had over 2,000 volunteers at just one location, at our Boone location, in the first 2 days. I can tell you we're going to be there to the end, and I just want to I would be remiss not to give a shout out to our leadership in the General Assembly. I mean, Tim has lived in the western part of the state since this storm. Representative Zinger, Representative Winslow came up the day after and with their own equipment and their own time on their own dime and helped out. They joined forces with Samaritan's Purse. They cleared streets. They cleared driveways. They helped people who were in need, and they did it out of the kindness of their heart. And I can't let it go unknown. But anyway, I want to say thank you to all the people from across this country, across this state, that are stepping up to help, because at a time like this, we need it. And I have seen North Carolinians be North Carolinians, and I've seen Americans be Americans. Thank you.
I'm Jay Adams. I represent the 96th District, basically Hickory, Conover, Brookford,
Hickory was on the fringe of the storm. We had a lot of rain. There was flooding. Streets were flooded and all, but we were left pretty much intact. So Monday morning, I made a phone call to the city manager in Hickory and asked him what was going on. He told me there was a problem at the airport. People were dropping off materials that they had nobody to handle and no place to store. So I made a call to Appalachian State, the Hickory campus. They gave us access to their parking lots. I called Performance Foods. They delivered a tractor trailer, so we have a place to store the materials. Over that week, the next few days, we had as many as 90 helicopters operating out of Hickory. We had helicopter pilots come from all over to service the area. They were dropping medical supplies and picking up people. They were evacuating nursing homes in Western North Carolina. These people pulled together from nothing on Sunday, and they were flying over 400 missions at their own risk, on their own credit cards for fuel for days. I did get to go on one of those flights, and they kept saying over and over again, you're at your own risk. You're at your own risk. They risked their lives to do what they did. They did it very, very quickly. They set up an air operation at the Hickory, the FBO, Quick Space Operations, and they set up a medical triage in the terminal. When FEMA guy came over, I don't know which day it was, several days ago, he walked through the air operation, and then he walked through the medical operation, and he said, I've never seen anything like this in all my years with FEMA. It was grassroots, and it was quick, and it was at their own risk, and they saved lives. And I'm absolutely amazed at what I saw. We had to set up a call center for the volunteers. We had so many people coming out to volunteer to accept the supplies and to distribute the supplies. We had restaurants. I think there's a list maybe of 40 restaurants that donated food for the pilots and for the volunteers that were at the airport. It was an amazing thing in many respects. It was obviously an epic disaster. We've always talked about the 1940 flood and the 1916 flood. 1916 flood was called the Great Flood. All measures I have seen, all the metrics I have seen, makes this much, much worse than those floods. You have to see it to believe it. But I do want to thank all the people who made contributions, who gave of their time, who risked their lives to do this. It was inspiring. I saw young people step up that probably never had been given responsibilities like they accepted. I saw leaders emerge from young people. So there's some good from this. It's a horrible thing, but there is some good from it. And I hope we'll document it. I hope we'll learn from our mistakes. I think we can refine things. We learned all week long how to do things better. It was innovation at its finest in a crisis. So what in all, it was horrible, but there was some good out of it. Thank you for being here.
You know, we're here to begin the process of the legislature stepping up and doing what needs to be done for the affected area. But it can't be ignored how much ordinary North Carolinians, whether they were in the affected area or they were somewhere else, just picked up and went to help their neighbors. And but for that, this would have been much, much worse. And those folks are still there. They're still on the ground. They're still doing great work. Volunteer organizations, individuals volunteering, that really is the heart of the recovery so far, and it will be a big part of what happens from today forward. So with that, we will take your questions.
Communication with Duke Energy about the power outages and what their game plan is to get the power back up in the mountains.
So I don't know that I can speak specifically to what they're doing. I've talked on multiple occasions with representatives of Duke, asked questions about what their strategy is and what they're doing. Suffice it to say that they are dealing with, like everyone else, a situation that is unlike anything they've seen before. And so trying to restore power to folks, I mean, in many respects, you're talking about downtown areas in Hendersonville that just got power back yesterday. And so the recovery as far as that's concerned is going to take a while. I'm more than happy to refer any questions. We'll try to get specifics from Duke, but I don't know that I can really speak for them at this point.
Yeah, I just wanted to see what role, if any, Democrats had in this, and have you spoken with the leadership there? Are they on board, et cetera?
So Tim and I met with the governor yesterday. ACE is starting to run together, but we met with the governor yesterday, with the head of emergency operations, with the head of the Department of Transportation. I kind of went over with them what we were thinking, asked for their input. There have been conversations at the staff level with the various agencies of state government. We have talked directly with members of the State Board of Elections and with staff on the State Board of Elections in pulling this together. I spent some time this morning with Leader Blue going over the bill with him, responding to questions that he has. So this is something that that I'm hopeful we'll have a unanimous vote.
I spoke with Leader Reeves yesterday and just gave him a general overview of what the bill did. That from my position, it looked like this is should be a bipartisan bill. I would be surprised if anybody voted against it. And he should have a copy of the bill. I texted with him, but I haven't actually spoken with him this morning, though.
More on the just how the bill came together. Did you talk to the specific representatives of the district, like, you know, at Senator Heiss and others, about specific needs, or is this just kind of the higher level with the agencies, what Cooper's request has been? And will this second round later in October address more of the specifics?
Yeah, a little bit of both. Obviously, the speaker has been talking to his members. I've been talking to my members. They've been communicating directly with staff. We have received from them inquiries, requests. Suffice to say, at least from what I've seen, a lot of the member input has been more specific on, can you get someone to take care of this that's needed right now? Not necessarily on the legislation itself. Since North Carolina has a lot of experience dealing with these sorts of things, one of the first things that we've done is we went back and looked at, okay, what are the sorts of things that we needed to do in previous storms? And we used that as a baseline to start from, and then we built from there.
Same from the House side on that. I'll give you an example. We had a situation we dealt with yesterday for Avery County, I believe. Avery County was trying to stand up a disposal site, and initially the DEQ was talking about delaying it because it was a mile away from where some bats lived. And so we dove into that a little bit, and they got it worked out, so they're going to be able to put the debris there. And so just trying to work through some of the regulatory issues that maybe should not necessarily be delaying things. But then also going there and seeing firsthand, I know Senator Berger's been in the western part of the state as well. A number of our colleagues have, seeing what the needs are and then looking at how we have responded to other natural disasters in the past, and then coordinating with the agency. But it is important, as Senator Berger said, this is just the first step. This is the first bill. I mean, here we are only two weeks later, and the legislature is going into session to immediately adopt legislation to deal with this. And then we'll be back on the 24th to deal with things there. Then we'll be back in November as well. So we have multiple opportunities. And this is not going to be a short-term thing. This is a long, this will be multi-years that this process has to be dealt with at the state level and at the federal level.
Laura Leslie, WRAL. Hey there. What exactly is the money going to be spent for? Like, where is this money going in? And is any of it going to direct aid to the survivors of the storm?
Yeah, I would say the bulk of the money at this point is going to provide some cash flow flexibility for state agencies to do the things that they're already empowered to do. The governor and the executive branch has certain authority under the executive powers that are in place when an emergency is declared. One of the things that we are going to extend the declaration, you know, the law currently calls for an initial 30 days and then another 30 days with Council of State. We're extending it into next year to kind of get that off the table as to whether or not that's necessary. So suffice it to say, there's not a specific earmark of any of these dollars for a specific program like that, but it does provide the executive branch with the kinds of flexibility that they would need.
Any plans for help towards damaged health clinics in that part of the area? And then also, could you speak a little bit more specifically about the water projects in terms of?
So a couple of things on that. So yes, the funds that are in here could help pay for those kinds of things as well, those to the agencies. With respect to the water, one of the conversations and meetings we had to do, we got a conversation started last week. I was talking with some of our federal partners, and I think it's worth pointing out that Congresswoman Fox and Congressman Edwards, along with Senators Bugg and Senator Tillis, who had been in that area, have been very helpful in helping us locate some resources and assets, such as temporary water systems. So some of the smaller towns, you know, perhaps Spruce Pine, I know is being looked at, Bakersville, Chimney Rock, of some mobile units that the U.S. Army has, to have those kinds of things brought in to go ahead and stand up some water treatment systems to take care of that immediately, things like the temporary bridges. And I know that the National Guard and that the DOT have been working on that as well. But those are a number of things to try to get temporary facilities. But as Senator High said, when you're talking about a town constructing a new full-fledged like water and wastewater treatment center, absent even this kind of disaster, that's a multi-year process and a very expensive process. So that's why I say that rebuilding is going to take a while, but we have been successful in locating some assets to try to get some temporary bases to get folks by. And those are things that are in the works right now. And those are requests that originated with these legislators who started saying, hey, are you looking at this, looking at that, and a partnership to locate those kinds of assets as well.
Senator Berger, I know you said this was a first step, but there's, and I don't know the exact number either, a $4 or $5 billion rainy day fund right now, and this package is for $273 million. So there are going to be some people who think this is not enough. Is this enough?
As far as the total that the state is going to expend, no, this is not all of it, not by a long shot. One of the concerns that we have to be aware of is that in many respects, a lot of what will be needed for recovery will be funded at the federal level by the folks at FEMA, and the state's obligation is generally for a match of some sort. You know, this money could be used for part of that match. I don't expect it to be used for that, but we don't want to get too far ahead of the federal government on that, because we don't want to supplant those federal dollars with state dollars if we're not required to.
And there's language in the bill too that points out that, you know, that we want to be careful in how the money is spent, that we don't forfeit the ability to get those federal dollars, because what it should end up being, if we do it right, is a 90-10 match, 90% borne by the feds, 10% by the state. But if you don't do it exactly the way it's supposed to be done, you can end up forfeiting those dollars.
And this will be the final question.
Senator Berger and Speaker Moore, Patrick Thomas with Spectrum News One. I know you both touched on the relief efforts and how the money's going to be dispensed to the state agencies. I'm wondering if either of you or both of you can explain a little bit more about how the $250 million will be given to the state agencies in terms of what state agencies receive that, and then how that will manifest on the ground once those agencies who need it most receive it.
Yeah, so much of that will be dependent on what the budget folks in the executive branch determine needs to be done, that they have a great deal of flexibility to move this money to the particular agencies that that need those dollars. So I don't know if they have any specific requirements at this point that those dollars will be deployed in a particular way, but it's as flexible as it can be so that they can meet the needs that are out there. Lauren, I think we're going to overrule you a little bit and take a couple more questions.
Thank you, Senator Berger, Speaker Moore, good to see you guys. Thanks for taking the question. My question relates to the provisions you talked about in rolling back inspection requirements. A member of the North Carolina Building Council warned my colleague David Hodges last week about this exact thing, especially because the General Assembly overrode a veto by the governor last year on a bill that further rolled back existing building requirements in the state that made some buildings more dangerous and susceptible to this disaster. So what is the General Assembly going to do to ensure that buildings and infrastructure that's being rebuilt meets code and is safe if you're relaxing these regulations?
So I don't think anything that would be in this bill as far as modification of ordinary process will impair the health, the safety, the required building requirements. A lot of it has to do with procurement and the way that you decide how to deploy the dollars to someone so something can get built. What we want to do is we want to make sure that the rebuild that takes place, to the extent that we're talking about something permanent, that we can get that moving as quickly as possible, not that we want to cut any corners as far as safety is concerned.
That's exactly it, to help try to help with the timelines. And I do want to push back on one point in your question, because there was a New York Times article that I thought was simply wrong, that tried to say that regulatory reform in these cases somehow made buildings more susceptible to damage. That simply is not true. And you can talk to folks who live in the mountains. I mean, you've got buildings that were destroyed that have been there 60 years. Right. I mean, and so that's just an unfortunate false narrative by some who want to try to play politics. I'm not saying you, but I'm saying the New York Times article, that want to play politics with a disaster at a time like this. The regulatory reform that's being looked at this is not to make less safe. It's to speed up the process and to make sure that we get things done soon. We don't need to be talking about, for example, repairing I-40 for 4 years before something's ever done. We need to get those roads built. We need those bridges back. We need those water treatment systems built, not just talked about.
Representative Plus mentioned some challenges initially that couldn't be met, or things that we generally didn't do correctly. Can you speak to, you guys are in a really unique position as you've been sort of on the ground in the mountains responding to this. I'm here in Raleigh, so I haven't been able to see some of those things with my own eyes. What are some of those challenges that haven't been met or things that weren't done correctly initially?
So I think now is not the time to litigate those sorts of things. I think there will be a time where we can go back and look at how things proceeded. I think Representative Pless made it clear that now is not the time for us to be doing that. Suffice it to say that we want to make sure everybody gets what they need up there. You're going to have problems. We're still going to have some problems, but what we want to do is identify those problems when they happen and try to correct them and make sure that we know the reasons so that in the future we don't have the same sorts of issues. I think we'll take one more.
Getting the look. I get that look every now and then.
So the elections appropriation is, I believe, $3 million more than the state board requested. Can you talk about how you arrived at that number and what the funds are going to be used for? Is it primarily voter outreach?
Yeah, so 2.1 million is what the state board requested. I think that's the right number. We felt that it was necessary to not only provide the state board with adequate resources to do what they're needing to do based on the changes that are taking place, but also some flexibility so that local boards could get some of that money and assist some of the cash flow issues and some of the shortfalls that they might have.
And of course, they also included more counties. So those things, and then also want to try to help the locals, because we know that the, you know, and you really, when you get to the ground, it's the local boards that are trying to find, for example, poll sites. They're trying to find people to work those. When you have poll sites, they literally no longer exist. I mean, they're not there, right? Like a fire department or a church or what, community building, that building is no longer there. And I know you all have shown the photos of what's happened and how just dramatic it is in these areas. But even just seeing the photos does not fully capture the extent of it. And the challenges that these local governments deal with is there. And I want to just add one more point. Some good comments have been made about the involvement of just ordinary people who just showed up wanting to help. And in the churches have stepped up in so many ways. If it weren't for nonprofits, if it weren't for the churches, if it weren't for just ordinary citizens, we would have a much bigger crisis on our hands than what we do right now. And I want everybody who reads or sees this to know on behalf of everybody up here, we appreciate that. The people of Western North Carolina appreciate that. And let's make sure that it's not forgotten about, because these needs are being met right now. But as laid out here, this is going to be months and months and months. And other things will come along that steal the headlines nationally and all that. Of course, Florida, we're praying for them with the hurricane that's bearing down on them right now. But the folks of Western North Carolina need to know they are not going to be forgotten. And I know that this state, as it always has done, is going to step up and take care of our folks.
And with that, thank you.
There you have it. That's what officials said today at the NCGA. More to come later when they reconvene to vote on the bill. Again, please subscribe and look at my past work at anniedance.substack.com and subscribe to have it directly sent to your inbox. Thanks for watching. See you next time.